This is County Connection, and I have with me tonight TASC, which stands for, notice how I'm using the laptop,
sure.
Treatment Access and Service Center. Treatment Access and Service Center. Did you get that? Yeah. I have with me Dan Milloy, who is, you're like the cheese, aren't you?
Well, I guess so. I'm the executive director is
that's
the
a
fancy
cheese.
Name for it.
Thank
yeah.
you, that's a cheese.
Okay.
And we have Deb, who is the worker bee.
That's right. She does the work. Right.
Do you like the way I got right there, too?
Yes, that's right.
Okay, now the reason you're here tonight is because one of our staff is on your board of directors.
Right.
So let's start right there. How big is your board?
We have 8 members on our board.
Okay.
Right now.
Do they all show?
Well, we're getting better.
Do you send out, like, the storm troops if they don't come in?
Well, we send a general email reminder. We just kind of ask them to show up because we buy a lunch form at every meeting. And
well, you should say, like, get here or I'm going to come out after you. Then they'll come.
Well, we might get to that point. You know?
Let me know. I'll get your troops together for you.
Well, your particular, our board member who works for you, Sandy, Suzanne Baer, has been great. I mean, she shows up every meeting.
Yeah, so. We don't let her out. Yeah. We don't let her out of that obligation. I want her to be there.
Well, that's a good thing.
Let's start, first of all, and I'll get you, I promise. Let's start, first of all, with what you're tasked to do. Did you like that?
I like it. I like it a lot. It's an awesome task that we have. Well, first of all, we're located in downtown Reading at 19 North 6th Street. We're on the corner of 6th and Court Street. And TASC, Treatment Access and Services Center, to make a long story short, we help people get into rehab every day. Last year, we helped...
Well, stop a minute.
Okay.
I want to get into rehab. How do I get a hold of you?
You walk into our door. 19 North 6th Street, right
okay.
on the corner of 6th and Court. I have a picture of our building, if you want to see that.
Sure, I'd like to see this. Is it the first one on there?
It's the second one.
Okay.
So that would be this one right here. We're located in the SAM building. We share space with Service Access Management. They do the mental health side. We do the drug and alcohol side. We're right on the corner, right across the street from the courthouse. And the best way to come and see us, Sandy, is just first come, first serve. We open at 8 a.m. Usually every morning there's about 15 to 20 people waiting outside of
no
the door.
No kidding.
Yeah. We're very popular.
Yeah, you sure are. So you, 6th and Court, yeah, I know where that is. That used to have a bank in the bottom, didn't it?
Yes.
In the bottom. Did you like that?
Yeah.
So you're in the third floor, 6th and Court.
Right.
People stand there. Mm-hmm. You open your door at 8 o'clock and they all come in.
They come flooding in. And
then what?
Well, then we first come, first serve. We meet with each and every one of them one by one. And we perform what's called a clinical assessment or a drug and alcohol evaluation. And
well,
we do,
hold on a minute.
Yeah.
How many counselors do you have?
We have 6 full-time evaluators. Okay. We need more. We have 2 openings right now. We'll be
okay.
filling those soon, I hope. And our job is to find out, we do what's called a level of care assessment. What does each person need? Do they need to go to detox? Do they need to go to outpatient treatment? Do they need to go to residential treatment?
How does this word spread? Do they just talk to each other? I mean, I never even knew you were there. Welcome to this
yeah.
world. How about it?
And part of the reason why we're here tonight.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
Hopefully, enlighten people as to who we are and what we do.
When you didn't call them counselors, what do you just call them, evaluators?
They're clinical evaluators.
Okay.
Yes.
What kind of background must they have educationally?
They have to have a bachelor's degree, and they also, there's a certain number of trainings that they have to complete each year that's required by DDAP, the Department of Drug and Alcohol Programs.
It's sort of like,
an
accountant has to get yeah. continuing education credits.
Yeah, and we are DDAP licensed, so I mean, we're not just anybody doing these evaluations. The state has a lot of oversight into our office.
When you have your bachelor's degree, do you try to get them in psychology, social work? How do you do that?
It can be any of those, psychology, social work. We even get some folks who have a bachelor's in criminal justice because unfortunately, 85% of the folks that we evaluate are connected in some way to the courts, either with adult probation or state parole or children and youth.
When they're connected to adult probation, are they sending the people over to you?
Yes.
So that they help to refer the people to you?
Yeah, TASC has been around since the early 80s, Sandy, and our name is even written directly on the court order for each person who gets sentenced.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, the judges have been very supportive. They know how important and how intertwined drug and alcohol use is with criminal activity.
So you're saying you're on the drug and alcohol side, and then there's somebody else on the mental health side.
Right. And that's service access and management. And the nice thing is that in sharing office space with Sam or something.
Yeah, you're on the same building.
Yeah. So if a client is kind of on the border between, am I mental health, am I drug and alcohol, or is it both? You know, Sam and TASC work together to determine what's best for that individual.
When they come in there, and then you see whether or not they need a residential facility, you see whether or not they just need counseling, you see whether or not they need not incarceration because you're not on that side of the law.
Right, correct.
How many different opportunities do you have to send them somewhere?
Well, there's several, and Deb gets involved in this process too. And
we'll drag her into it, don't
yeah,
you?
She knows how much fun it is every morning. Our evaluators will contact several detoxes and rehabs throughout the state, and we'll find out, do you have an opening? And if so,
how tough is that?
Oh, it's very tough.
That's got to be a bugger.
Especially when the detoxes and the rehab facilities are normally full.
Yeah.
But we contact as many as we can. That can be 8, 10, 12, 15, 16. Just tonight, before I came here, I stayed at the office because we had a gentleman who was evaluated by one of our evaluators, referred to rehab. Pyramid Healthcare came down at 5:30, picked up this gentleman, and is currently driving him to Pittsburgh to one of their facilities.
Word.
So we'll do anything we can to access and get these folks, you know, into
when
treatment.
When you get them into treatment, do you find that it's better to geographically separate them from their roots or to try to keep them in the community?
That's a real good question, Sandy, and I guess it varies per individual, and it depends upon what type of family and home support they have. You know, that's a big part of it.
Because the real trick is when they get out, they almost have to flip their lives.
Yeah.
And not go back to the same environment that they had before as far as friends and
yeah.
Not especially family, because I'm sure family is going to be as supportive as they can to help the person out.
I'm going to flip to a slide here.
Go for it.
This is called peer support. DDAP and the Council on Chemical Abuse, who also funds us, COCA.
No, wait, hang on a minute. DDAP,
Department of Drug and Alcohol Programs.
Thank you.
And COCA, which is the Council on Chemical Abuse. So that's a plug to my good friend George Vogel.
Oh, he's such a good buddy.
Isn't he?
He's such a good buddy.
So we realize, and the state realizes that, gee, we spend a lot of money to send these folks away to rehab. But what happens when they come back?
Right.
We put them in the same environment.
Right.
And they relapse, and should we expect anything
start
different?
Start all over again.
So now we have something called Recovery Support Specialists, who are ready and waiting when folks come back from rehab.
So they're assigned to this person.
Yeah, it's voluntary. The person has to want it. But while they're in rehab, we kind of stoke that fire and kind of let them know, look, you're not alone. We have 8 full-time recovery support specialists who are ready and willing, and many of these folks have been through TASC.
Is this all part of your staff?
It is.
So you have 6 evaluators. You're looking for 2 more.
Right.
And you have 8 follow-uppers. My word, not yours.
They are follow-uppers, right.
Okay.
And they're hand-holders.
Yeah.
You know, they take these folks to drug AA meetings, NA meetings. They help them, take them to job interviews. They teach them financial skills.
What do you do about housing?
That's another issue. They work with,
EDI.
EDI and right,
YMCA.
Some of the, thank you, Deb.
Do
some
EDI,
of the halfway houses
EDI,
and so
EDI, easy does it.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And the YMCA.
Some of this I know.
Yeah, there's a lot of acronyms in this business.
Oh my goodness, in government.
Yeah.
In government, CYS, DRO, yeah. JPO, APO.
But we also work with the Hope Rescue Mission. I mean, some of our clients are unfortunately homeless, but we do what we can to help them get on their feet again. That's a neat part about what we do. Yeah, we evaluate and we refer to treatment every day, but then we're also there for that support when they come back to help them stay in recovery and get engaged in recovery so they're not alone.
I know that you try to measure, and I'm not forgetting about you.
No.
Well, her time's coming.
I know that you try to measure the success of your programs.
Right.
How much do you see, because I'm sure that as many as you can help, there's that many pushing back to get through the doors.
Yeah.
What kind of repeat do you see?
Yeah, we do get repeats. We get several. I don't know the exact percentage, but I'm going to say
50?
It's probably at least 25%. Would you say, Deb?
But that's pretty low.
Yeah.
That's really pretty low.
Well, it's... you know, hopefully I'm not missing the mark on that. Maybe. Am I missing the mark on that?
A little bit.
Okay. Maybe it's more like 33. I mean, addiction, unfortunately, is that kind of a disease.
Oh, yeah.
In which, you know,
you might battle it three or four times until you finally get it licked.
And our evaluators, you know, we're trained to look for the signs and symptoms of this disease, okay? Whether it's, you know, somebody using alcohol, heroin, cocaine, marijuana, whatever. But unfortunately, not just like with cancer, not every disease of addiction is the same. Okay, we know what to look for, but we know that if this person has a heroin addiction and this person has the same, it's not the same result, it's not the same dynamic for each person. It's different.
Let me jump to you. What do you see in the age differences? Do you see all ages or do you see a lot more young people?
All ages, especially right now. Mm. We have just as much senior citizens as we do 14 and 15
year olds. No kidding.
Yeah. I can't say that there's one age group right now that...
Do you get hit with a lot of vets, veterans?
Some. I wouldn't say an overabundance of them, but yes.
Boy, it blows my mind that you have senior citizens coming in there that need help. What kind of drugs are they on? Are they on
medication?
Mm-hmm.
They get addicted to their medication that was prescribed by a doctor.
Like pain pills?
Yes.
And they know to come into your office?
Unfortunately, sometimes they come in other avenues. They come in because they got a DUI because they were driving on their medication.
And then the judge sends them.
Yes.
Right. Wow. Where do you start to help them? Wow. Are there certain facilities that deal with different age groups? Like, is there something where you can send the seniors that they have a support group around them, and then another one that you can send 20 to 35 year olds, that there's a support group around them, or you just throw them all together?
Most of our facilities treat everybody. There are some outpatient providers, though, that have turned to specialized groups where they have the elderly or the senior citizens in a special group.
Talk about that a little bit, where they're not actually living there. They're just going, are they going weekly for counseling?
Yep, they're going like once a week up to three times a week.
And then do they have to take drug tests?
At the treatment facilities,
uh-huh.
Yes.
And so they go for an hour and talk to somebody and try to get through this?
They can go an hour, they can go an hour and a half, or they can go 3.5 hours a day.
Wow.
There's different modalities.
And how much do you try to lead them into AA or what's the one for drugs?
NA.
Thank you. That's Narcotics Anonymous, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I couldn't remember which one acronym was. How much do you try to lead them into that?
Our recovery support specialists do a great job. Our outpatient counselors, outpatient facilities also direct them into the 12-step program. But I think that we're more in open. We might try AA, but if that doesn't work for them, then we might try church or we might try a different modality for them.
Do you know where all the ones are all over the county where they have the AA and the NA meetings?
Correct. Yes.
How many are there? Do you have any idea? Mm-hmm. Hundreds?
Good question.
Yeah. There's
at least 10 or 15 meetings
a day. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. There's quite a few. Berks County is very strong. The Berks County Recovery Program is very strong.
And then do you also help them find something close to them that they can go to for NA or AA?
Absolutely, yeah.
So you also do that. What are you supposed to be doing in there every day? I'm here asking you.
I'm going to cue this up.
I'm here asking you all this good stuff.
I'm going to kind of segue that and then turn it over to Deb.
Okay.
TASC also works out of the jail. Okay. We have a program there. We call it the pilot program because we never came up with a good name for it.
Well, that's a good name for it.
You know, well, it does kind of, it launches people into treatment.
15 years later, it's a pilot program.
Yeah, probably still will be, yeah. Every month, we evaluate and send 15 to 20 people from jail into rehab. And normally it's long-term rehab. And then, of course, when they come back, we have these recovery support specialists, you know, waiting, you know, to help them.
Well, hang on a minute. You say 10 to 15 a week?
No, I meant a month. If I said a week.
Okay, so they're being released from jail. You grab them when they come out.
Right.
They go, and you send them into a facility.
Well, they actually go right from the jail. This is a cooperative program with, again, DDAP, COCA, a lot of acronyms coming.
That's okay.
The county CAO, or the county public assistance office, the welfare department.
Okay.
And adult probation. For individuals who are on probation or parole and they violate their probation and it's drug related or alcohol related, instead of going back to the courts, once they're committed to prison on their violation, we evaluate that person. We work with adult probation. We work at the county assistance office, turn on their welfare benefits while they're in jail, which prior to this time was unheard of.
Right.
And then that individual is released right to the rehab. They don't go home or anything. They go right to the
rehab.
Are they
given a choice?
Of which facility? Not really. No. We're going to kind of make that
Are they given a choice of coming out of jail and going into their old apartment or going to a rehab?
No, not really. If they want part of this program, they're going to go right to rehab. But now
and
we have,
they're so happy to be part of your program.
Well, it does get them, you know, out of perhaps a revocation hearing or a lengthy jail stay. You know, we get them right into rehab. But now we have another program, and that's where Deb comes in. We call this the Jail Medication Assisted Treatment Program. This is part of the state's outreach and their efforts to combat the heroin epidemic, the opiate epidemic right now. We realize that not everybody makes it in a 12-step or abstinent-based rehab. Some people are, you know, they've been in two, three, four times into various rehabs or in and out of jail. So now we have another program at the jail that's called the Medication Assisted Treatment Program. That's a different tract for those people who have been violated from their probation and incarcerated because of their drug use. So it's a little bit different. Instead of sending them to rehab, we do something different. Now I'll turn it over to Deb. This is her specialty.
And what do you do?
We meet with them in the prison.
Yeah.
The doctor in the prison, the medical staff of the prison is also involved. And we put them on medication prior to their release from prison.
Huh. And does that help take care of the withdrawal and all the rest of that stuff?
The medications do take care of withdrawal, but our hope is that they take care of the cravings, and that the client would stay on the medication for 3 months and then get released from jail.
So they would get the medication in jail for 3 months and then be released.
Then be released.
Talk a little bit about Camp Joy.
A housing program.
Yep.
The YMCA runs it. It's a housing program. It's all male. Still, I believe. Yes.
It's all male.
And it's a supportive housing environment where the individuals get the same things they would be at EDI or the YMCA. They have case managers.
They go there to live.
They go there to live.
And how do they get into that?
Probation.
Okay.
Makes a referral.
So they're going to go from adult probation or juvenile probation over
no
to
juvenile. Juvenile. No juveniles there.
18 on up.
Yep.
Okay. And I think you can house 21 folks there, but I'm not sure. I can't remember exactly how many.
That sounds about right.
Yes. I can't remember exactly how many.
Yeah, and
there.
I believe they've been full.
Yes.
Oh,
yeah.
I believe they have. Boy, it's gorgeous. We did
it
a
is.
Whole bunch of we did
it
a
is.
Whole bunch of renovations. Well, we didn't.
Yeah.
Mr. Vogel did. Mr.
Yeah.
Vogel found the funds.
Yes, he did.
How many caseloads do you try to carry with your counselors? And I keep using the wrong word for the counselors, and I'm sorry.
The
about
evaluators?
That. Yeah.
They don't have caseloads. They see different people every single day. So there's not a caseload that they carry.
Well, then the people that are going to hold their hands when they come out,
right.
They have to have a caseload.
Yes, correct. They all have caseloads.
How overwhelming is that?
They each have 30 to 35.
That's a lot, isn't
people
it?
People on their caseload, yeah. Yeah,
wow,
it is.
Wow, that's a lot, isn't it?
Yeah.
But it's so important. It's just so
oh,
important.
You're telling me.
Important.
You're telling me.
Especially now with the heroin epidemic.
Yes.
Is it really that bad?
Yes.
Boy, I'm so out of that. I'm out here in the courthouse looking down from the 12th floor at your third floor thing.
Yeah. Sandy, I have a slide up that I hope, if we could show this.
We can show whatever your heart desires. We have 5 minutes and then we're off
really?
Here.
Yep. My goodness. This is the part of what's called the warm handoff program. This is running in every county in the state. However, Berks County has been a leader in this program. We're very proud of the work that our recovery sports specialists do in this respect. It's for opiate overdose survivors. We work with Dr. Barbera from Reading Hospital and also with St. Joe's Hospital. And anytime someone is committed or presents at the hospital for a heroin or opiate overdose, and that individual is revived by Narcan and brought back to life, mm-hmm. The hospital works with the individual and they call us. We run a 24/7 hotline number. The number's on the screen there. It's 610-988-0685. We get a call. One of our recovery support specialists will report to the hospital within 30 minutes or less, and then we help that person get into rehab or detox. It's unfortunately been very popular, which means, you know, it's good in the sense that the hospitals are working with us. The nursing staff has been fantastic, both at Reading and St. Joe's. The bad news is that many people are overdosing. We've had, I believe, 20...
Is it the cops that are carrying the drug to counteract it?
Some departments are. Narcan, some of the police departments are, not all. The EMTs, I'm not sure if all of them carry that, but I think most of them do. But in any event, we've had over 20, I think we had 22 overdoses so far who have responded to this program just in the month of July alone.
Oh, my.
Since
word.
March, we've had over 100 individuals who have overdosed in Berks County.
And they were brought back.
They were brought back, revived by Narcan. And then what happens then? I mean, do we just send them home or what do we do? So luckily, the state with DDEP and Gary Tennis intervened and said, well, let's try something. So they started this warm handoff program, and our staff has done just a fantastic job. Karen Ferguson and her staff, we respond, and 70% of these 100 people who have overdosed, we've managed to get into some form of treatment.
Oh, my.
So we're very, you know, proud of that.
Do you have any slides you want to show? 3 minutes.
3 minutes. I don't know. What do you think? I think we should avoid the rest. Maybe we'll quit while we're behind.
I just want to say this program is so key. I mean, the overdoses are just... phenomenal. Yeah. I know.
Well, you're blowing my mind with these numbers. Yeah. 22 in July. You're just blowing my mind with these numbers.
Yeah.
And let me just give you another point. Like, we have clients that overdose, get right back up and start using within the hour. So, I mean, Karen's staff is out there, you know, seeing the same clients we saw OD the day before. So.
And Sandy, we had an overdose in our office last week. We had an individual waiting to go to rehab and overdosed, and we managed to revive and bring that person back to life.
I feel so insulated. I feel so insulated.
Oh, we have fun over there, don't we? Yeah. And that third floor.
You just deal with this all the time. Mm-hmm. Don't you burn out?
Well, Deb, you've been there 15 years. You haven't burned out yet.
No, I haven't burned out yet.
I might, but you haven't yet. Our staff is resilient. They're unbelievably dedicated, Sandy, and I don't know what we'd do without the people that we have. I mean, in this field.
How big your staff?
We have approximately 30 people.
Okay.
Yeah, between the case managers, the evaluators, and so forth.
And where do you get your money?
We get it from CCBH or Medicaid, and we also get it from, you know, the state or from COCA. You
from Council on Chemical Abuse.
Right, that's where we get our money. We're their front door.
What's your yearly budget? Do you have any idea?
Yeah, $1.8 million.
And how many, what did you say, 30? You had 30 staff people?
30, yes.
And you have 8 board members?
Yes.
And how many clients do you carry a year? How many goes through your doors?
Well, last year we had 6,673 individuals who reported for some kind of evaluation or recovery 6, support.
6,673.
Right.
For 30 people.
Right. Yes.
Well, you certainly don't have to worry about why you're getting out of your pajamas in the morning, do you?
Well, I guess not. I mean, unfortunately, and especially as Deb mentioned now with this heroin and this opiate crisis, unfortunately, we're very busy. You know.
I thank you for being with us. I'm sorry we're out of time. It was most fascinating. I knew nothing at all about your whole organization other than the fact that my pension coordinator once a month would disappear into the night, go somewhere for lunch, and then come back later on and say, oh, I'm so excited. By the way, please say hi to George Vogel, George Kavari.
Oh, I will.
My bud.
I will. Our board president, he's been a great support.
He and I parked beside of each other for years, and we never hit each other's car.
Wow. Imagine that.
Thank you so much for being with us. Good night.
Thank you, Sandy. It was a pleasure.